Howdy.
Welcome to Cheminformatics for Undergraduates, Lecture 001. In this course, my goal is to give you an introduction into cheminformatics and how you can start to manipulate molecules into exploring different types of chemical systems and applying it into different fields. Some of the prerequisites for this course is that we've kind of assumed that you've taken organic chemistry and that you have some knowledge of computer science, whether mostly revolving around data structures. So to begin this lecture, we are going to start off with just how to record chemical data into the computer. If you remember from organic chemistry, when you had to write a simple molecule called propane. So here, propane is a 3-carbon length molecule. And when you had to name the molecule, you had to also give it a rank order of the numbers. So we're gonna rank number the carbons here. 1, 2, and 3. Back in the 80s, when they wanted to record this chemical compound into the computer, writing it through this type of skeletal structure is not actually easy. So how would you write that into a text file? Traditionally, you would put the name, propane. Over time, the names of chemicals often change, and so that became a little bit more ambiguous. So in the 1980s, someone developed something called SMILES, which is a simplified molecular input line for one dimension. So how to convert it into a 1D string. For propane, if we know that there's 3 carbons in here, in our language, we say C, C, C. And if we put these letters next to each other, where there is no denotation, meaning like what their connection is, we assume that it's a single bond. This makes it pretty easy to actually write a lot of structures as compared to something that's like the skeletal. So let's say if we wanted to do something as simple as butane and extend this propane out. And here we have now the butane. And if I label the carbons appropriately, we have 1, 2. So recording data this way actually became very useful, especially in modern times, because you can record any types of chemical structures with this type of nomenclature, but allow it to be manipulated. So if we wanted to extend our alkanes into something more like a decane. The power of writing chemical compounds into the computer, so something as simple as butane, is that to change the structure, it's very simple. It's a one-letter switch. So let's convert butane into butanol. So we want to now get to. So one thing that we could do is take our butane and add an oxygen at the end of it. In the computer, we assume that these are all single bonds, if you remember, and here is a single bond between the carbon and oxygen, which I'll mark with this line. The hydrogen here is actually assumed. So in when we write SMILES, we assume that all the hydrogens are forms at full. So if in reality I wanted to write it, it'd be CH3, CH2, 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 and OH. But that's not very, when you include hydrogens like this, the string kind of looks a little bit ugly. And then also it's not a very interesting element to add. And so we just assume it in our language and we can kind of infer. So it makes it easy to write these chemical structures into the computer. This is where the manipulation of the strings really becomes important. And what happened in industry was because of the low cost of designing these new compounds or designing new strings. So it becomes very easy to just create a new compound like this, where we have 1, 2, 3, 4 alcohols and some length of a carbon chain. So, and then we can record that into the computer. Now, is this compound useful? Does it exist? Don't really know. What happened in the recent years is that we have these big chemical databases. And so you'll hear about these in our field, the zinc database, the enamine database, and PubMed. A lot of these databases all have this explosion of small strings. And so variability that they added. So what happened is that it created this data explosion. And so the zinc database is at approximately 2 billion compounds. So there's 2 billion strings in there. The enamine database is sitting at 21 billion strings. And the PubMed is around, I think, a couple hundred million. So you have all these large chemical data sets, and figuring out what's useful and how to apply it to the different fields and filtering out these compounds is what a cheminformatician does. Power is how to manipulate the structures yourself and understand what properties you can gain from a compound to solve your particular problem for your system. One of the easiest ways to start kind of like playing around with manipulating these strings to make them do what you want is easy conversions of like converting an alkane to an alcohol. So let's move over here and start writing some code. So I have Python installed, and here I will be testing something simple. So let's take our alkane. So we have butane, and we say butane is 4 carbons long. Now, if I print the length butane, you'll see that it returns 4. So this kind of gives us a little bit of an avenue of, okay, we can at least get the length of a molecule or a length of a string. And if the power of this is if you have some sort of big data set, so chemical list. So here we're gonna print out every length of each chemical in the list. And here you can kind of see that, okay, maybe we can kind of start to infer something from this chemical list, that we've got propane, butane, hexane, and some 16 carbon long chain compound. If we did this on mass scale, you could actually get the length of all the compounds in, let's say, a billion. One of the things that we can start to do, and this is kind of what they did to build those bigger databases. So the zinc database was kind of constructed from using different parts of small strings until combinatorially they came up with consistent new unique patterns. And the reason why they did this is because not every chemical is known, and there's an infinite number of combinations. We just don't know what's the most useful. To get an idea of how they actually did that, we're gonna kind of run through that same exercise where you manipulate your own strings and create your own data sets. For our particular alkane one, we would like to just convert these all into alcohols, meaning that we're just gonna append an oxygen at the end of each string. So for each chemical in our list, I'm gonna put an alkane chemical list here, alcohol chemical list. Now, for each alkane in the list, we're gonna append an oxygen to it. So this is alkane. So here you can see now that we have a list of alcohols. We have a propanol, a butanol, a hexanol, and some 16 carbon chain. And that was relatively easy to do. And so it took about a second to generate 4 new compounds from 4 existing ones with 1 letter switch. So you can kind of understand the power of what's going on here. So to kind of end this quick little lecture and to kind of start you guys off slow before we move on to the next set, so where we would start branching out into different more complex alkanes or complex alcohols, I'd like you just to try a very simple example where we have a pentandiol. So here I'll label the carbons 2, 3, 4, 5, where the alcohol connection is at the first carbon and the second alcohol connection is at the 5th carbon. So in your exercise, what do you think the small string would be and how would it look like? For something a little bit more complex, if I drew something like this, where instead of the 1,5, which is here, it's now on the 1,4, what do you think the small string would be? So I'll leave you guys with that question for now, and then in the next lecture series, we'll talk about it. And if you would like to go through the lecture I've posted online with this additional content, which might help you answer that question, and subscribe if you would like to continue on these lecture series.